All right, good evening. Tonight, the BrentWord Communications, publisher of the Brentwood, Franklin, Nolensville, and Spring Hill homepages, sponsors a debate for Tennessee House of Representatives Districts 61, 63, and 65. It's a pretty simple format. Candidates will have a 90-second introductory statement, and then for each question, they will have 90 seconds to answer. Their opponent will have 30 seconds for a rebuttal. We're going to start in reverse order of the districts. First with District 65, we're presenting incumbent Jeremy Durham. His district represents a vast geography in western Williamson County, including Fairview and most of Spring Hill. Mr. Durham is unopposed in the primary, but has been challenged by school board member Bill Peach, a Democrat in the general election, who is also here tonight. And if you've understood the rules, we're ready for an opening statement from Representative Durham.
Thank you. I want to thank BrentWord Communications for having us. I want to thank all the media who've come. I want to thank all the citizens who think enough of our community to be here and be engaged. I always want to thank my pretty wife, Jessica. She's wearing purple in the back with the sunglasses. She's nodding her head at me right now. But I feel like that in the last 2 years in Tennessee, we've done some good things. Rather than what happens in Washington, we do things right. We took a $270 million deficit, and we balanced our budget because that's how we run things in Tennessee. In Williamson County, we have a AAA bond rating because we know how to run things in Williamson County. In Tennessee, we do things right. I feel like in Washington, we don't. In Tennessee, we look for ways to bring businesses to our areas. We know that cutting red tape on small businesses helps jobs come to Tennessee. We know that we must maintain a reasonable tax rate and not overtax people so they can keep what they earn. We also know that just like the reason that Jessica and I moved to Williamson County, schools are extremely important. We want to make sure that Williamson County keeps its place as the top-ranked school district in the state. We want to make sure that Tennessee is the best it can be.
Thank you very much. Bill Peach.
Let me start with some biographical notes, if I may. I was born on the south side of Boston, in the southern edge of Williamson County, educated in a two-room school, went to Hillsborough High School in Leaper's Fork, did my college at Lipscomb and MTSU, received a Bachelor of University Studies in 1988 at the age of 51. Since then, I have done other work at Lipscomb in philosophy and education and at Columbia State in sociology. Education is my first love. I first came to the school board in 1976, Franklin Special School District. Served there 8 terms for 16 years. Thought I would never go back. In 2002, I ran for County School Board, District 10, and served 2 terms and lost in 2002. I think what I want to do is sort of maybe change the conversation about public education. I think there are rumblings of privatization and vouchers and charters and textbook revision that I would like to address. I think I've done everything I can do at the school board level, and I think now I would like to go to the state and do that.
Thank you very much, Mr. Peach. Now we have a panel of questioners from local media, including Jessica Pace from BrentWord Communications, Jamie Page from the Tennessean, Pam Horn from the Williamson Herald, and Tom Lawrence from WAKM. The first question goes to BrentWord Communications.
This question is for Mr. Durham. The county has designated funding for working with local and state level government in the coming year on addressing transportation issues across Williamson County. What are some of the ideas you have for addressing traffic and roadway problems?
One of the issues that we're facing right now as a county is that our population, and this is a good thing because Williamson County is such a popular place to move, but our population is growing faster than our infrastructure. So what you'll see is you'll see city leaders, county leaders, and state leaders working together. One of the projects that impacts My district specifically is the Mac Hatcher Project. We were very disappointed this year that the Mac Hatcher Project did not get placed on the three-year plan. We're hopeful that it might next year. There were some federal matching funding issues that I believe prevented Mac Hatcher from being fully considered. But I do believe going forward that's a very strong likelihood that you'll see it on the three-year plan. There's also Spring Hill. There's a lot of issues down there. There's always talk about an interchange, and I know that the city of Spring Hill is talking about putting in some money, but I think right now the shovel-ready project in my district that everyone's talking about, that I'm going to put pretty much my full legislative influence, for lack of a better term, behind, is the Mac Hatcher Project.
All right, thank you very much. Mr. Peach, you have 90 seconds, and Mr. Durham will have 30 to rebut if he needs to or wants to.
On
same question.
One of my first calls was from someone in Spring Hill. Apparently 31 South is very congested. We've just gone through an amazing inconvenience. I live beside Mac Hatcher Parkway. The growing pains are horrific. I, of course, would support anything that improves traffic flow. I live right beside Mac Hatcher. I went through two phases of that. I understand what it's like. I would love to see it make its way all the way around as it was intended to do. But it's something we have to do. We're growing at an amazing rate.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Durham. Nothing? All right. The next question goes to the Tennessean.
I had prepared this question, didn't know it was going to be in this order, so it may be a lot of overlap here. Spring Hill is one of the fastest growing cities in the state, and traffic congestion is their biggest challenge, especially US 31. What would you do to try to improve the traffic situation there in regard to state roads?
Well, there's already, the problem is I think 2025, there's already something on the TDOT schedule for, I believe, 2025. Right now there's an interchange for Thompson Station Road there. We would need to move that to the Buckner Road, where there's the 0.8 miles, where that it doesn't extend all the way. There's two different schools of thought. There's the widen 31 folks, and there's the build an interchange folks. You know, personally, I'm going to listen to Spring Hill and let the mayor and let the BOMA tell me what they want to do. But Spring Hill, growing like it is, they went from about 7,000 to 29,000 in one census. I know that most of the lots right now have been developed, but you know, when they get the utilities on the other side of the interstate, you're going to see that happen again. I'm not sure that there can only be one main road going north and south in Spring Hill. I know that that's been brought up recently at some of the BOMA meetings, but as far as their needs, I'm going to support them. I don't think they're anywhere near as close as the Mac Hatcher Project is to getting very serious consideration for funding on a three-year plan. But TDOT does know the need is there, but there's a lot of hurdles, and there's a lot of, you have the MPO, the Metropolitan Planning Organization. I mean, they set the funding, and it just takes a long time to move up and rank on that.
All right, thank you very much. Mr. Peach, roads in Spring Hill.
That has to be one of the priorities. I would listen to the municipalities, the mayors, and of course, we sort of function at the mercy of TDOT, but anything that we can get in money that comes to Williamson County, I'll be there as an advocate.
All right, Mr. Durham, last word. All right, from the Williamson Herald, Pam Horn, please address your question to Mr. Peach so we can reverse the order now.
Bill, you have been involved in education for decades locally, and I wondered if you, in your quest to have this position, feel that the local boards currently, how they are serving relative to what the state expects them to achieve on a state and national level. And what would be your position as an elected state representative to support the local boards in their efforts?
I had a two-hour session with Tim Gaddis, who is our assistant superintendent for testing, learning, and assessment, to see what I thought about Common Core. One of the first things that he told me was that we were far ahead of their standards already. So I approached Common Core with sort of a passive attitude. I'm not opposed to it. I'm not a strong supporter. But I think there needs to be probably a national standard that would bring the rest of the country to where we are. And I think one of the reasons that I'm running, in so many instances, the actions of the state legislature has contravened the wishes of the local school board, and I'm here to defend the local school board.
All right. And now the next question goes to Tom Lawrence of WAKM.
I didn't get that question.
Oh, sorry about that. Worried about the timer here. Mr. Durham.
I disagree that there absolutely must be national standards. I feel like that if you want to mess something up, you should let the federal government handle it. I feel like Tennessee and Williamson County do a pretty good job. You know, I think it's very important to take input from the school board. I think the only standing meeting we've had the last 2 years has been on those Saturday mornings when we've talked to the school board. However, you also have to keep in mind that it's the parents who educate children, and the government just helps. So you have to keep that in mind. We have great schools in Williamson County. I enjoy working with our school board, but just have to keep in mind that while they are number one, you also have to make sure that parents have their seat at the table, because that's very important.
All right. Do you have a last word, Mr. Peach?
I guess my question would be, which parents? Because quite frequently, the people who are involved, in particular with textbooks and decisions, are people who come representing groups as opposed to being an independent parent.
All right, thank you very much. And now, Tom Lawrence, please address your question to Representative Durham.
First, it's mighty good to see Jim East back in the saddle. Yesterday, the governor of Tennessee came to Franklin to swear in a new justice to the Tennessee Supreme Court. And he made a pitch. Very directly, he asked people to vote a particular way in November in a referendum. This is a two-part question. Number one, will you vote to retain or reject Connie Clark? And why? And then can you explain what the governor was asking us to vote for in November?
I can't speak exactly. Are you talking about Amendment 2?
Yes.
I thought that's what you meant. I'll start with Amendment 2, and then I'll talk about all three justices. Amendment 2 is basically a modified federal plan for electing judges. Right now, the state constitution says the Supreme Court justices shall be elected. Now, the Supreme Court has said that a retention election is sufficient. Some people think that's okay, some people don't. The governor is very supportive of Amendment 2. There's a lot of people, including one of my constituents today, who said we should either change the Constitution or we should start following it. Because many folks don't like the direct elections, they want to go with Amendment 2. I think that's where the governor is coming from. You know, I'm not really sure that I'm going to support Amendment 2. The best man at my wedding carried it through the legislature, but you know, I don't know that I want to change the Constitution because we won't follow it. I just don't know that that's why we have a Constitution. So I'm torn on it. I don't think I'm going to vote for it, though. As far as Connie Clark, I will tell you I'm not going to vote for the other two. I'm undecided on Connie Clark. I think she is the best of the three as far as being reasonable. I like her personally. You know, I think she's great for Franklin. I like bragging to the rest of the state, saying that 40% of the state Supreme Court is from Franklin. So that will heavily influence my decision. But, you know, I really don't want to commit either way right now on that.
All right. Thank you very much. Mr. Peach.
Do I have 90 seconds?
You have 90.
In the last 2 days, I have received two mailers from a group that was pretty vicious, asking us to replace Connie and the other two. I have talked to several people who are part of the Judicial Committee. The thing about appointments that I like is that they are vetted by their fellow judicial people and the lawyers, as opposed to people who are popular within their particular party. I will definitely vote for Amendment 2. I will definitely vote for Connie Clark, in that I don't know a lot of the others. I think Jeff Bivens maybe is on the list. I would certainly vote for Jeff. But I definitely will support the Second Amendment. I mean, Amendment 2, not the Second Amendment. We'll do that later. But anyway, yes, I would.
All right, last word to Representative Durham.
I just want to make sure that everybody understands. It's Sharon Lee, Gary Wade, and Cornelia Clark, who are the three justices on the ballot. Holly Kirby and the new justice, Jeff Bivens, are actually the two that are not on the ballot. I just want to make sure everybody understood.
Okay. Now back to BrentWord Communications for a question addressed to Mr. Peach.
Opinions about Common Core aside, can you define what Common Core is and give an example of standard versus curriculum?
The first access that I had to Common Core was the night it was introduced, and it was sort of a madhouse. And I sort of decided, based on who was opposed to it, that it couldn't be entirely bad. So I have tried to talk to people within the education community. I get mixed feelings. I think from what I read that, and from what I'm told by the assessment people, that it is primarily standards, that it has very little impact on content other than the transition to critical thinking skills, explaining your answers, rather than filling in bubbles on a standardized test. I think we need to give it time and see how it works. We can fine tune it, and somewhere down the road, I think it's gonna work. And if it doesn't, we'll replace it with something else. But I think we need to give it a chance. It wasn't dead on arrival.
Mr. Durham has 90 seconds.
I just know that when I've knocked on doors and I've listened to my constituents, many teachers are very concerned about Common Core. At least from what I've gathered from them explaining it to me, let me use a direct example of someone in Sturbridge who said this. They said, "Jeremy, it's like if my husband put a roof on your house. Would you want them to explain the name for every phase of that and use a lot of vocabulary, or would you want to make sure that that is a well-finished product that can withstand the worst storm?" I said, "Well, I think I would be results-based more than process-based." Some of the teachers worry that it's too process-based and it doesn't emphasize getting the right answer as much. Kind of like if you have to explain why 2 + 2 = 4. Well, it just is. And there's some teachers who think that perhaps it goes too far in the process-based parts of it.
All right, last word to Mr. Peach.
That, to me, is not the major issue. There are other parts of the educational process that we'll get to later, but like vouchers and for-profit charters.
All right, thank you very much. Next question goes to the Tennessean.
What do you see as the single greatest state legislative issue for Williamson County?
Just for me.
Yeah, you can. It's for both. But.
As I mentioned before, my first priority really is education. I think there is an undercurrent across many areas of the southern states, primarily, to privatize public education. The concept of public education is probably the greatest thing that ever happened to this country. I mean, we started in colonial days in which we educated the very few. And at some point, we decided compulsory attendance, educate everybody without major cost to parents. The trend seems to be to vouchers, or as they call them, scholarships, a process in which public money is transferred primarily to sectarian schools. And you all know that children who come from failing schools are not going to get in BGA and Innsworth and Brentwood Academy. They're going to be limited to schools that are church schools and that do not perform any better than the public schools. charters and vouchers have not been proven to be academically superior.
All right, Representative Durham, can you answer the greatest state legislative issue for Williamson County?
Well, I think the greatest issue would be 1A, 1B, and 1C because they're all intertwined. When people look at coming to Tennessee and bringing a company, they look at Williamson County because of schools. So if we're going to cut red tape on small businesses to attract jobs so we can have well-paying jobs in Williamson County, we also must have good schools. Employers also look at how much money people will get to keep. I think not having a state income tax is a good thing. I think that moving forward and making sure we don't have unnecessary regulations on our businesses is a good thing. And I think having the top education system in Williamson County in the state of Tennessee is why so many people choose. There are a lot of reasons to move here, but that is the main reason that people choose to make Williamson County home, is because of the education system. So I can't answer it with one, because I think education, low taxes, and keeping our economy strong are all, I think they're all interrelated as one.
Last word to Mr. Peach.
I didn't mention earlier, but I was very instrumental in the design and implementation of Streetscape for downtown Franklin. I spent 24 years on the school board, two school boards. I spent 36 years on the Franklin Housing Authority. I feel like I have contributed greatly to what makes Franklin attractive.
Thank you. Next question to Representative Durham from Pam Horn.
Representative Durham, you mentioned the $270 million deficit that you all overcame by balancing the budget, but I wondered if you could explain how the $200 million in projections that failed to come about, how in your estimation that happened within state government this year. That was quite a shock and a surprise to the governor and to the legislators. And I'm wondering if we're talking about holding revenue sources down, is anyone examining the just the overall strategy of how we're holding those revenue sources down and what kind of impact they're making on day-to-day operations, especially given the federal government's predicament? If you could answer that.
The great majority of the $270 million, but not all of it, was due to the franchise and excise tax. And I want to be very clear, there were very legal ways that people were getting around it, but people were just finding ways that if they moved things across the border, that they wouldn't be taxed on it. There were a number of ways they could do it, but that's what happened, is a number of very large companies realized how that they could legally avoid franchise and excise taxes. And now I believe it's become a problem going forward. So I do think you'll see another deficit next year. The revenues are still down. We're going to have to make some tough decisions. But we made those tough decisions last year. We have to balance our budget every year. And I think that's a very good thing. But yes, it will be another tough year. It'll be another tough budget. We were very lucky to get Columbia State. We didn't get Mac Hatcher. We're going to try to get that next year. But again, it's going to be a tough year, and we're going to have to make tough decisions. But that's why we signed up for this.
Mr. Peach.
It seems that every political sign in the county has the word conservative. And I love it when people come as a conservative, lower taxes, but they promote better education. Somewhere there's a minor contradiction in this. I don't know how to deal with deficits. I have not been in the state legislature. That's something I think I can deal with when I get there. I have 52 years of business experience. I own my own business, so I do understand economics. I have minors in business administration and economics. So that's something I will deal with when I get there without any working knowledge of it now. But I certainly will not neglect public education nor roads and infrastructure in Williamson County. I'm not sure exactly how I feel about the hall tax. I know I oppose state income tax because it's a duplication, the same way I would oppose federal state tax. But if we repeal the hall tax, I would want to know how we replace that revenue.
Last word to Representative Durham.
The thing about the Hall Tax, I mean, the thing is, we had to replace $270 million, and that's more than the Hall Tax. So I think it can be done. The thing about the Hall Tax is it's a tax on Williamson County. Depending on the year, between 25 and 30% of the statewide revenue for the Hall Tax is generated from Williamson County. So any Williamson County legislator must push to eliminate the Hall Tax.
All right, from Tom Lawrence to Mr. Peach.
Attended a school board forum last Thursday night, and if they didn't have Common Core, they wouldn't have much to talk about. There was one really good question from an engineer. It said, are we at the right place? Should we be complaining to the school board, or should we be complaining to the General Assembly, or should we be complaining to the U.S. Congress? Can the legislature just give counties the right to opt out, or is this something that really Marsha Blackburn and Lamar Alexander and Bob Corker should be addressing?
Who's that to?
Is that to me?
That's to Mr. Peach first, yes.
Let me talk about big government and stratification of government. One of the big objections to Common Core is that it came from the federal government, when in fact it really didn't. It was sort of bribed into existence, maybe through federal money, but it came from the Governors Association. When I look at big government, I don't always think of the federal government as being the most tyrannical. I think the intervention at the state level sometimes can be more intrusive on local school boards and local educations than the federal government. When you consider how much or how little of federal money goes into education and how few the dictates are coming from the federal government, really, we are governed and funded at the state level. You know, eventually it has to come down to Williamson County. If Williamson County decides to opt out, I would certainly support that. If they decide to stay in, I will support that.
Thank you. Mr. Durham.
Well, I think to answer the question, although the federal government certainly could require states to adopt the Common Core standards, I think it's highly unlikely that states would not be able to opt out. You're probably going to see that at the state level. The standards, in my opinion, they were developed by the National Governors Association, but the federal government has just taken them and ran with them. And you see, whether it's Common Core or whether it's No Child Left Behind, you see these different education standards or programs come along every few years, and they're supposed to do all these things that they don't necessarily do. Before we subject our children to something that's not proven, I would like to see it work in other states before we talk about following through with it in Tennessee. I do not want to adopt the Common Core standards at this time. I voted to delay the PARC testing, which is the testing associated with the standards, until it's proven that it works in other states. I do not want to have Tennessee children tied to federal standards.
Last word to Mr. Peach.
We've probably whipped that horse all we need to. It's amazing how divisive it has been. I think if you look at all the issues, when you look at what the public perceives to be two slates of officers for the board, it is probably the single most divisive, along with maybe textbook censorship.
Next question from BrentWord to Mr. Durham.
This question actually is specifically for Mr. Peach to start with, because you've reiterated that you're running for State House to represent the voice of public education. What specific areas of public education do you see lacking or a need for change, and what's your plan of action?
First of all, let me mention one of my pet peeves. When I was on the board 4 years ago, when Guns and Parks was passed, the governing body for competitive athletics ruled that if that law was in effect, that we did not have access two public parks. The school board voted 12-0 to ask the county to opt out. The county commission, I think, voted 19-5 or 20-4 to opt out. We thought that was resolved. The state legislature has reintroduced that, I think, and Jeremy can address that, as to whether or not our children will have access to public parks. I think I will oppose vouchers and for-profit charters. With charter schools, if you take the brightest kids or the kids with the most supportive parents out of a failing school, you still have a failing school. If we're going to do charters, I would like to see a company take over the school and do whatever it is that they say it will do. But what we have found, if you take the same students, that charter schools do not perform any better than public schools.
Representative Durham.
Could you repeat your original question?
What specific areas of public education do you see lacking or a need for change, and what's your plan of action to address those issues?
Well, this may be a little bit of a non-answer, but I don't necessarily know that I'm really wanting to change a whole lot of anything. We have the top-ranked school district in the state. I think our schools are actually moving in a good direction. And typically, you'll see the legislature vote exactly how local school district says. There's always a few bills, though, where we don't, because we have to think about, are we as a state taking too much power from the local education association? On issues like that, I'm almost 100% of the time voting with the local education association. It's when I think that perhaps a parent, like let's take homeschoolers playing sports. One of my constituents made the argument to me that if a child was not attending a school, then it would be unfair for the legislature to allow him to play sports in that locker room because of what might happen. I believe that's up to the parents. I think that's something that his parents should talk about with him or her in their living room or in their kitchen table. I just don't think that the government should be making calls like that. So when it comes to high-performing school districts having more flexibility over what they do with their education dollars and things like that, I'm going to be with the LEA. When I think that parents are being are losing some control that they should have, I'm going to be with the parents.
All right, thank you. Mr. Peach, rebuttal.
Let me just for a moment address the letting homeschool children participate in sports. To me, that is a total violation of every principle of public education. I would never support that.
All right, thank you. The Tennessean has the next question, this time for Mr. Durham.
Tennessee gives a lot of financial incentives to businesses to come here and has clearly been very successful at doing that. And there are, two schools of thought on that and whether the payback is worth it. And what is your philosophy on giving financial incentives to businesses to expand or move here, and or what would you do to attract them?
That's a really good question. From a practical standpoint, it's very hard to take that money out of the budget because it's part of one bill. We vote on it was $33 billion state budget this year in one bill. So it's not like all of those projects or all those expenditures are approved on their own. You really have to think about this. If it is going to bring jobs to Tennessee, we have to consider doing it. And, people call it corporate welfare, and, I really am very hesitant to support giving one company an incentive that another company didn't have. But we also have to remember that we are in a fight, a constant fight with our neighbor states to have the best economy we can have, to have the most pro-business state so we can compete for jobs. We also have an ever-broadening global economy. We're really not just competing with Kentucky and Alabama anymore. We're competing with the internet. We're competing with other countries. So while the principled conservative in me does not like the idea of providing incentives to a company that another company didn't get, we are in a fight to be as pro-business as possible so that we can keep taxes low. So I think there is a time and a place when you can do it.
All right, Mr. Peach, you have 90 seconds on that question.
In the 52 years that I was in retail, I was also in the Chamber of Commerce. In almost every situation, the Chamber of Commerce supported tax breaks for new industry. And in many cases, I supported that. Once they started talking about tax breaks for malls, then I changed my mind about how I felt about that. It's really a delicate balance because it tends to favor the big folks in deference to the little folks. And there's also enough advantage already. If you bring in a plant that employs 2,000 people, that's nice, but they're also competing for workers and employees in the smaller factories. It's a trade-off. I think you have to look at each case individually and how much tax revenue you're losing and how many potential jobs it will bring.
All right, 30 seconds available to Mr. Durham.
Well, I think I agree with most of that. You've just, the thing is, I'll just stress the same thing I stressed before. We have to think outside the box. There's other states that want to be pro-business around us. The thing is, you wouldn't really lose revenue because it's not revenue that you wouldn't have already had. So that's, you know, I'm usually very by the book, principle conservative on things like that, and wouldn't be somebody who would typically agree to providing an incentive for a company to come here. But we're fighting other states, and any reduction in tax revenue wouldn't have been there anyway if they hadn't come.
All right. Pam Horn, Williamson Herald, to Mr. Peach.
You had mentioned earlier just about the state constitution, the parameters that we have, and I wondered if you've thought at all about the fact that the school board memberships of all of our school boards are nonpartisan, and this would be something that I would question. Is that something that should continue? Because there are rules and policies in place that say that school board members need to stay nonpartisan, and that is carried out on the ballot. In fact, I saw the ballot today and it said nonpartisan. I never really realized that was on there. But is that something that we need to continue, because there seems to be a lot of interest in funding school board races from partisan-based organizations?
Williamson County is a three-party state: Democrats, Republicans, and the Tea Party. Tea Party people are not listed on the ballot as Tea Party. The divided slate on school boards usually is ideological rather than partisan. The first few years that I ran for school board, the first people that would sign my petition would have been the chairman of the Republican Party and two Republican members of the county commission. It never occurred to me the first time I ran that it was partisan. Still believe that until 2010. And in the race, the first picture in the paper for publicity was a picture of my opponent with Glenn Cassada and Jack Johnson in front of Republican headquarters. Consequently, I lost the race 37-63, which basically is the makeup. Whether or not you like to believe it is political, if people know which party you're in, it pretty much takes care of you, and you'll win or lose on that basis.
Right. Mr. Durham.
You know, partisan school board races, it's not really something that I feel strongly about either way. When I'm knocking on doors, I'm hearing about how that you got to protect my small business, how you got to eliminate the hall tax, how that we need stronger schools, how that, you know, my wife is a teacher, and you know, she thinks there's too much red tape right now. I could go either way on it. There really hasn't been a need to. I think this is the first time that there's probably a little bit of an ideological divide. If it becomes where that voters are identifying with one side or the other, then perhaps we should. But at least in the elections before this one, I don't know that it's really been necessary.
All right, thank you. And the last question of the District 65 comes from Mr. Tom Lawrence.
Is it government overreach when a community says it doesn't want guns in their parks and the General Assembly says you don't have a choice?
Mr. Durham.
Well, there's two different schools of thought. And I'll start with this again. When I knock on doors, I hear about cutting red tape on small businesses, keeping taxes low, improving education. But since you asked, there's people who say, well, the city has built that park. It's the city's park. Why are we telling the city what to do? But then there's some other folks who are saying that the taxpayers built that park. And if more taxpayers want to carry their weapon consistent with their Second Amendment right into a park, then they should be allowed to do that. If there are enough taxpayers to convince the legislature to do that, I don't consider it government overreach. I consider that just what happens in government, the way government's supposed to work.
Mr. Peach.
In the Constitution, there's a lot of emphasis on the 10th Amendment. We have sort of overlooked the 9th Amendment. There seems to be a catchphrase that state governments enjoy all of the things that are not prohibited to them by the federal Constitution. What has happened historically is that states have imposed legislation that violates individual rights, I think. One of those is guns in parks. It's a balance of whether a person has the right to carry a gun to the park and whether or not other folks and children have the right to access to a park without guns. Now, we all know that there's no way to keep an illegal gun away from a playground, but it has been proven that there's more danger when there are more guns. I'm a defender of the Second Amendment, but I would love to live without wondering why somebody brought a gun to an eighth grade baseball game.
Last word, Representative Durham. All right, great. And that'll do it for the District 65. We're running a little bit over, but we're still on track. And thank you very much. And if you could change places with Representative Glenn Cassida and his challenger school board member, Sherry Hammond.
Thank you.
We will proceed.
Thank you.
If you want to, if you come up with it, you're totally, I just printed these up because I was compiling whatever was happening. As long as we're still taking turns, I mean, do whatever you want.
As Bill Peach is a school board member challenging Jeremy Durham, Sherry Hammond also is a school board member challenging Glenn Cassida. Sherry Hammond is running as a Republican in the primary. You'll have to wait for the District 65 race to the next election. District 63 represents Eastern Williamson County, and that includes Nolensville, Triune, College Grove, Thompson Station, and parts of East Franklin. So we're happy to have you here tonight. The last set of questions leaned heavily on schools, and we certainly expect these as well because of the nature of the race. And if the questioners are ready and the candidates are ready, we would like to start with Representative Cassida's opening statement.
Well, let me say thank you guys for doing this. This is the heart of a democratic republic, is the media and the public calling the elected officials into account for what they've done or what they want to do in the next 2 years. It is an honor serving Eastern Williamson County in the state legislature, and as I look across, I'm humbled by my family and friends that have turned out. And I do this not for the money. Obviously, it's not much. I don't do it for the fame. As a matter of fact, there's some outlets in Nashville that have questioned my hereditary over the last little bit for the stances I've taken. I do it for my granddaughter, who's back there in the back. And my goal is for Tennessee to enact legislation that's a shining light for the rest of the nation. We want to cut taxes, we want to cut government, and we want to devolve power from government at all levels to the citizens of this county, of this state, of this nation. We in Tennessee have been quite successful at that. My caucus has elected me chairman of the caucus, third in leadership, and with that leadership role, working with leadership in the Senate and in the with the governor and leadership in the House, we have attained those goals. As your state representative, I have been very diligent in representing your conservative values in Nashville. The income tax deletion will be on the November ballot. That's my bill. I've implemented something called the Office of the Repealer, which is a outside-the-box way to cut, I'll wrap up if that's okay, Jim, to cut a red tape that's on business. And I thank you for this opportunity to serve you and your values in Nashville.
All right. Sherry Hammond has 90 seconds.
All right. Good evening. Thank you all for joining us tonight. It's a pleasure to be here. Glenn, it's a pleasure to be here with you as well. Yes, my name is Sherry Hammond. I'm running for District 63, State House of Representatives. I'm running because, to me, it's all about being the right person at the right time. And over the last number of years, it's been my joy to be able to serve, lead, and represent the people of not only my district, but also the county in a myriad of ways. I bring 30-plus years of experience, first as a CPA by trade in the business sector, then as a stay-at-home mom, as a leader in the nonprofit world, as a consummate volunteer, especially with our schools, and now as a public official, as a school board member for District 6. My motivation, my passion, is all about good governance, not politics as usual, but bringing forth the principles that I hold most dear, things like honesty, integrity, and wisdom, and always bringing forth common sense while we value the people around us. My focused intent is to guard against government overreach at all levels, to bring forth a spirit of collaboration, and also to make sure that when we do have legislation in place that it's sound. It's also a privilege of mine to be able to offer a choice to the people of my district, something that we haven't had for 10 years. So I look forward to the questions and to our debate. Thank you so much for coming.
All right, if you're ready, we'll start with BrentWord Communications.
This is for Mr. Cassada. Some say that House Bill 2249, which includes parents on local textbook committees, overrides existing school policy. What do you think this legislation will accomplish that current local policy does not?
First and foremost, I think my reason why I want to serve you in Williamson County in the district is to empower the people of the county. The founders of this country did not envision government picking textbooks. They envisioned individuals being in charge of their own destiny and being in charge of picking the textbooks that their children read. And so the goal of this book, the goal of that bill, was to involve parents in the selection of an advisory and consent role for the textbooks.
All right. I guess we'll go to Sherry Hammond for 90 seconds.
Okay. Thank you. You know, there were two different bills out there. There was Bill 2321 and then this bill also that was passed. And they both were referring to content review or textbook review. Specifically for this bill, which, let me say first that there was reform that was needed to happen at the state level for the textbook adoption. I totally agree with that. But I will say that the piece that did include putting parents into an advisory, actually as part of the advisory committee, that which the teachers right now are part of, is an override of local control or local policy. We have policy in place right now for parents to be a part. It's very important for parents to be a part, and we offer that now in our policies.
All right, last word goes to Mr. Cassada.
Yeah, I think the fundamental difference between Sherry and I is we always tend to get back to this role of government. I am a 10th Amendment guy. I want to see you as citizens being in charge of your destiny, in charge of your taxes, and in charge of those things that affect your family. I think Sherry and I have an honest disagreement. It's what we take place across this country. But there are some Republicans that want government to still be in control of certain areas. Picking textbooks is a good example. I want you as a citizen to be in control, as the founders of the country intended.
Thank you. Next, with the Tennessean.
Local governments often complain that the state balances its annual budget partly on the backs of city and county governments by passing down more funding mandates for expenses that traditionally have been the responsibility of the state. What is your position on the increase in state mandates?
And before I could comment on something vague, Jeremy, if you don't mind, give me a specific.
Right.
Specifically, what are you talking about?
There's a lot of requirements for things for police and fire equipment, things like that, that they used to get state funding for. There's a lot of small examples. I guess I really can't think of a really large one at the moment, but it does come up frequently anyway in local government meetings, you know, that the state funding mandates.
And let me jump, because I understand your question, is until the Republicans took over the majority, that was a true statement. But in the last 4 years, under the leadership of Governor Haslam and Speaker Harwell and Speaker Ramsey, Lieutenant Governor Ramsey, you don't see that. And in 4 years, I cannot recollect, and I could be wrong, but I don't recollect any state mandate that costs money coming down to local government.
Sherry Hammond.
I think I can speak to one of them. One was, for example, the park test that was going to be enforced, and now, of course, has been delayed for a year. But getting ready for that, there certainly were not enough of funds that were coming down from the state, and that absolutely became a burden on our local government. So park test is one example. And I do just want to add, when I have a moment, that, you know, Mr. Cassidy said that we have a difference in that I don't support parents' engagement. That is so unequivocally wrong. I have to address that. I mean, I'm a parent that for the last 16 years, I have poured myself in coming alongside our school district and giving parents every opportunity possible to be a part. So we do, that just is an unequivocally wrong statement that I needed to get cleared up.
All right, thank you very much. And
can I follow up with one question on that? In addition to, when we're talking about state mandates, perhaps a better question on that is with roads. The state funds its own budget with that, fully funded, but it does now require the cities and counties to fund a big portion of that before they'll do the projects, basically. Otherwise, they'll end up so far down the list. I mean, it can make the difference between 5 or 10 years. Otherwise, if they're not chipping in, and those are state roads,
they're state roads. That's correct. And to your point, because of the federal funds drying up, and in all honesty, because of the federal government going bankrupt, we have some real problems because of gasoline being used and the revenues from the gas tax decreasing. We do have issues with roads. You're exactly right. And in order for cities to move up the ladder, if you will, they are putting more of their money in. But it's by choice, not by mandate. In other words, if Spring Hill wants Highway 31 widened, they can't come to TDOT and say, we'll pay half, and so it's going to be done tomorrow. That's not how it works.
Well, it's not by choice, though. As from my conversations with TDOT, is that it's not. It's not it's not their choice. They have to contribute.
Well, a city can choose not to contribute,
right.
And then your statement's correct. They're pretty far down the list.
Yeah.
But again, it's the city's choice to come up with some of that revenue to work in cooperation with TDOT to move their road project up, right?
The state's road project.
Correct, the state's road, which is used by the citizens of the state of Tennessee.
All right, Sherry Hammond, would you like to debate?
Just one thing I'd like to point out, and this got brought up yesterday in when Mayor Anderson was talking about the state of the county, I almost said state of the union, the state of the county address yesterday at the joint meeting. You know, one of the things is the roads obviously are a huge issue, both at the state and the local level. And there are certainly some laws in place that he refers to often that disallow the cities and the municipalities to be able to work together to overcome some of these issues that they come up against. That they do have the burden to have to cover the cost of their roads. And so can the county and the cities not work together in order to share some of that burden that they obviously do have because they're not getting full funding from the state?
All right, Pam Horn.
This is actually for Sherry Hammond. Sherry, let me ask you why Williamson County voters should trade a chairman of the House Republican Caucus, who has quite a bit of power on the Hill, as Glenn alluded to, and has been there for 14 years, for someone who is a newcomer to state politics?
Mm-hmm. You know, I think there's a couple of different things, and some of the ways that we differ. Number one is our experience and our skill sets. And I think that as a Tennessean, I certainly support electing citizens that have been successful first in the private sector, and that they bring more than just government experience to the table. As I have been traveling the district for over a year now and talking to thousands and thousands of people, literally, you know, I hear that quite often. They think that fresh ideas and new perspectives are healthy and that they're good. So one is our experience and my skill sets. Obviously, being a CPA by trade, there are not any accountants right now, CPAs, in the State House of Representatives. I think that's a valuable skill set. I think it's also our motivation and our focus. I think you can be in a position too long, and sometimes your focus and your motivation can change. And that usually comes out as sometimes some politics as usual procedures, I'll just say it that way. Also, I think a spirit of collaboration. I'm really known for one, and I have a proven track record of bringing forth a let's come alongside and work together. And that collaboration has been very much lacking, I believe, in the last year.
Glenn Cassida.
Well, let's be clear. This legislature is a part-time job. I am a full-time sales for an animal health company. I've been in with that one company for 31 years. I've taught high school 1 year. So my experience is most definitely the business world. And I've been quite successful in sales with the company that I'm with, being the leading salesman a couple of times the last few years. And what I bring to the table is collaboration, Pam. Nearly every elected official in the 63rd District has endorsed me. And they've endorsed me because I work well with them. And they understand that I can take their message and their needs to the state government and work with state government and get those things accomplished. Yes, because of my senior position as number three in leadership, but because I work well with local government. And that's why they have endorsed me.
Can I follow up on that, Mark?
Guess we're getting out of hand. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I just was curious. You said in the 63rd District, folks have endorsed you. I haven't heard about that, and I wondered who that might be.
We released a letter, and I'll have that released to you shortly, Pam. You should have got that the other day.
Okay.
We asked those that were representative part of the 63rd District. So, for example, a Fairview folks, mm-hmm. we didn't ask for their endorsement because sure. it's Fairview. But, yes, we will make sure you get that. You should have got
sure.
it.
Sure, we'd love to see
You obviously
that.
Didn't. We will make sure you get that.
County commissioners from the 63rd
yes,
District.
From city, county, school board, et cetera.
Very clear. Tom Lawrence, WAKM. Did you not get your rebuttal?
Was the question directed at Ms. Hammond first? Am I mistaken? Yeah, so no rebuttal. Okay.
Common Core. As a member of the media should never admit they don't know anything, but this I don't know, and I will ask. I understand the question goes to Ms. Hammond first and then to Representative Cassida. The state of Tennessee, the General Assembly voted to accept $500 million to implement Common Core. Would you have voted, Ms. Hammond, to accept that money? And to be honest with you, Representative Cassida, I don't know how you voted, so I'm going to ask you, how did you vote?
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me say this. I certainly would not have voted for it if I had not read thoroughly what it was all about. And in actuality, you know, we've heard a lot that Common Core wasn't even talked about when that vote was taken, but it was. If you look back at House Bill, I believe it's 7010, which was the first of the top piece of legislation that was passed back in January of 2010 by a specially called session, if you read the fiscal note that's attached to it, it speaks of Common Core standards. And then also when you look at the grant application that was put through, it's a 260-page application. But if you just go to page 14, it talks about Common Core standards. So I think, first and foremost, I can absolutely say that I would have read thoroughly and understood what was going on and what was being talked about at the time.
Tom, you never ask a question you don't know the answer to, and that's a fair question. When we ask about this term, this foreign term we'd never heard of, Common Core, the Department of Education was pretty succinct in saying that's just an increase in standards. We need this responsibility. Grant this authority to us. We will bring out us from under No Child Left Behind. Remember, at that time, No Child Left Behind was an utter disaster, and it had preceded a GOES 2000. It seems every 5 or 6 years that somebody thrust upon the states some cockamamie idea that's improved standards and is going to increase education, and it fails miserably. And so if the mistake was to trust the Department of Education with this new thing called Common Core that they guaranteed us was improved standards and would help the education, and we trusted them, that was a mistake. I strongly, and I will come out today, and I challenge Sherry, you do the same thing, where you stand. I am adamantly opposed to Common Core. I will work tirelessly to overturn it. It is bad curriculum, bad standards.
All right, thank you. You have 30 seconds.
Let me just respond to that last comment. First of all, this is my position. I am against federal overreach into our state's education system and override of local control. I am certainly for our state. And it's, by the way, it's our State Board of Education that issues standards. I'm certainly for them having minimum standards that are relevant, rigorous, and rightly aligned. My position is this. First and foremost, it's all about state sovereignty. State sovereignty has been reaffirmed. Since state sovereignty has been reaffirmed, I absolutely believe that we now need to have a review of these standards. They've been in place for 3 years. I don't think that's a big onerous task. Our teachers are very well vetted with them, and they can absolutely, I believe, in a succinct time period, review those standards. Let's review them. The ones that are good, they'll stand. The ones that are not good, let's tweak them, and let's move on. This is certainly an issue of public confidence. It's something that I hear about all the time. But we have got to come back to a place of unity. We have got to rise up in the authority that we've been given so that we can work and go forward on behalf of all the students of Tennessee, that we give them the best education possible.
I think that was the rebuttal. Yes. Okay. Let's go back to BrentWord Communications.
Common Core standards have been implemented in Williamson County schools. So what can be done in the meantime to address and alleviate the concerns surrounding the standards, and what are those concerns?
The concerns, as I knock on doors, literally tens of thousands up to this point in the past year, the thing that parents are concerned about is that it's a de facto federalization of our education system. And when that happens, states like California and New York drive the agenda and drive the textbooks. That's not good for our Tennessee values. There is no compromise. A total overhaul and rejection of Common Core is what I will be advocating and pushing for. Six other states have done that. Governor Jindal, who was in town this weekend for Jack Johnson's event, was very successful in helping the legislature overturn Common Core. And that is my goal.
Sherry Hammond.
You know, again, this approach that we need to completely repeal it and then go back to standards. What do we want to go back to? Standards of 2007, when there was a 2008? That's when the governor, then Governor Bredesen, had an absolute call to action. We had gotten a truth in advertising, an F in truth in advertising. Do we really want to go back 5, 6, 7 years? Let's take, the state of Tennessee has continued to improve. Williamson County has continued to improve. Our students are doing exemplary jobs. Take what we have now. If it's not working, then let's fix it, let's tweak it, and go on. I don't believe you have to throw it all out. And we have to reiterate that these standards that have come down from the State Board, these are minimum standards. When they come down to the LEA, we enhance them. Not only do we enhance them, then we teach far above and beyond. So we need to recognize these for what they are. Let's tweak them if we need to tweak them, and let's keep going forward.
All right, 30 seconds for Mr. Cassidy.
Well, I interpret that. I think you're finally admitting you were for Common Core, because next year in the General Assembly, there will be a bill, yes or no, for Common Core. And so there'll become a point where you've got to say, I'm going to vote for that bill, and I'm going to vote against the bill. The greatest improvement in the state of Tennessee occurred when we were not under No Child Left Behind, and a very small percent of the schools had implemented Common Core. That was the greatest growth in Tennessee schools. Let me close by saying this, that if something is wrong, you need to turn around and
all right,
stop there.
Jamie Page.
What do you see as the single greatest state legislative issue for Williamson County?
Let's start with Representative Cassidy.
In the short term, it's roads, without a doubt. We are growing so fast that the infrastructure is not keeping up, which in turn will hurt our ability to reach out and recruit business. And so we need the legislative delegation is in the process of working with TDOT on prioritizing those things that need to be done. I'm proud to say that right now, on a total dollar level, more dollars are spent in Williamson County per capita on roads than any other county in the state. I'm proud to say that we got the expansion of the Triune intersection. Those who live out there in College Grove and Triune, you know what a mess that is. TDOT will be expanding that. They just announced that yesterday. That was a year endeavor working with them on that issue. Highway I-65 southbound, northbound will be expanded, and it will be done next year. That will greatly relieve that traffic down to Thompson Station, and from there to immediately go on down to 840. And so there's a lot of road projects, and we take care of our transportation needs. That will help us recruit business and create jobs and opportunity for all Williamson Countyans.
Sherry Hammond.
Well, I will agree with that first part there, that as I've been traveling the district, absolutely what I hear probably more than anything, there are three things, but I will start with that. One are the roads. So absolutely, that's a huge issue. The other two, of course, is education. And then also I get many, many questions about the Hall income tax. But again, I've got to go back and say, in no way did I say that I supported Common Core, and I think that's irresponsible to try to say, put words in my mouth that I've said something when I have not said that. What I said was that what we have in place, I'm certainly willing to put the solution forth because it's a matter of public confidence that we address the issue, that let's look at what we have. Let's have our teachers rise up. One of the big concerns about Common Core that we hear a lot is that there weren't Tennessee educators, that participated. Well, let's get them participating. Let's review the standards, tweak what we need to tweak, and let's go forward.
Thank you very much. Pam Horn, Williamson Herald.
Representative Cassidy, you had mentioned that in the textbook situation, you wanted to have more parental input, and obviously the state does have a role with our public schools. Tomorrow morning, Columbia State Community College will be breaking ground on a huge new campus, and we have really never had the presence of a higher education campus to this level. Columbia State's has been here for a long time and been superb, but they now need obviously more facility, and part of that will be a library and a lot more classrooms for students. What do you feel like is the role for you as a state legislator on those kinds of textbook questions that come up in a junior college? The textbook that was at issue actually was an AP textbook that mostly seniors took those courses, and many of whom were already 18. And I'm curious if this is an issue that you think might extend to a junior college as well.
No, I don't. Actually, I would contradict that, Pam. The textbook that I was shown by multiple parents was a 10th grade book. And it had gross things about, and I mean just untruths about poverty is the cause of, capitalism is the cause of poverty in the world. Well, that's just blatantly untrue. Capitalism is what creates wealth and gets people out of government control. And there were many others. I could belabor it for an hour, but I won't.
Well, I only challenged that because I gave textbooks out this year at Franklin High School, and I handed that to several seniors. So that may be my confusion, that there are a lot of 10th graders taking that AP geography class.
Right, and I can only say that and multiple parents that showed me the book said it was a sophomore class and that their children were sophomores. So obviously if we're dealing with adults, that's a totally different paradigm than when you're dealing with 13, 14, 15-year-olds, 16-year-olds that are in high school and middle school. And since I got more time,
good.
Let me say, I'm just shocked at the resistance that there are amongst some that we don't want parents plugged in to the point where their opinions and their advice determine the direction of the school board. Thank you.
Sherry Hammond.
Parents are so plugged in, and they are part of the process. But back on this, on this textbook, and I will say, too, that the human geography class, it's offered to freshmen, sophomore, and others. It is actually an AP, which is an advanced placement level class. That means it's a college level class that students in high school can take. They have to take it with first with their parent permission, so because it is an advanced level class. And I'd like to speak about the one point that Mr. Cassidy said about that textbook was teaching that capitalism leads to starvation, because that was a soundbite that was taken out of context. Very disappointing, very disheartening as a school board member, as a parent, to see that happen, because that was picked up and ran with. That one line came out of, I think it was page 68. I could be wrong. I think it was page 68. It was in a chapter, which was in a section, that talked about overpopulation and food supply. And within that, that was one paragraph, and the paragraph was talking about what a 18th century philosopher, Marxist philosopher, believed. And it was probably five or six sentences, and that Marxist philosopher believed that. It was not that textbook, nor Williamson County Schools, nor the state of Tennessee, was teaching that that capitalism leads to starvation.
Thank you. Mr. Cassidy.
Yes. I get tickled how you can have your blinders on. And that statement was there. It was unchallenged. It was presented as a fact. It was taught as a fact and unchallenged. And I'm sorry, when you have a 14, 15-year-old child and you make that statement and it's unchallenged, then that is bias, and that needs to come out of the textbooks. And that's why I want parents in charge of picking the textbooks.
All right. Tom Lawrence, WAKM.
How conservative are you? Saw a picture in the paper today, beautiful, glorious picture of some handsome guys cutting a ribbon on the latest edition expansion of MacHatcher. I love that road. It helps me to get from Cool Springs to my home in south part of Williamson County in almost an hour now. But
on a good day.
We got more than a road. We got a park too. Hundreds of trees. A serpentine walkway. When all we asked for was asphalt. Mm-hmm. How conservative are you?
I guess I'm second on this one.
Sherry Hammond.
So are you asking as far as how conservative I am as far as would be allocating funds like that to do more than what's needed? Is that what your question is?
Fair enough.
I think we need to be fiscally responsible. And to me, being a conservative is bringing forth common sense. I consider myself a common sense, free market, Ronald Reagan conservative. And what that means to me is that it's all about fiscal responsibility. It's about low taxes, about balanced budgets. It's about bringing forth common sense. It's about guarding against government overreach. So we have to be fiscally responsible. So without, I suppose what I would say is I bring my business sense into that. And you have to see what the need is, what dollars you have to allocate to it. Do you necessarily mean that you go above and beyond? No, you meet the need. And especially when it comes to using government funds, taxpayers' funds, then you need to be very careful, very conservative, that you're meeting the need, but that doesn't always mean that you go above and beyond.
Mr. Cassidy.
Tennessee is one of the few states that does not owe any debt on their roads. So I would say, right off the bat, very conservative. Now, to your point, could that road have been built cheaper? I had to sit down with TDOT and ask them that question. I don't know the exact answer to that question. We as legislators, we do two things. We approve a budget for the various departments, and we pass laws that govern the citizens of the state. We pass a TDOT budget, and we trust them to be, and under Governor Haslam and his people and his administration, I trust the governor to be the most efficient with the taxpayers' dollars. When I see something that, as you pointed out, Tom, makes me ask a question too. It's a very good observation on your part. That will spur me to ask the commissioner and assistant commissioner, could it have been done cheaper? Mm-hmm. I don't have an answer tonight, but I'll find one.
The reason I interviewed the mayor of Franklin recently and asked him the question, who's going to water those trees? Mm-hmm. Because Franklin, sometime before August, won't have the water to water those trees. And he plainly told me that the city of Franklin will have to take care of the median. And that seems like it's, well, I'll leave it at there. I'm not an office holder, but it seems not right. But that
and I don't
appreciate your answer.
Term, but just for information on all those projects like that, the city and the TDOT do work together. So Mayor Moore and his department, Highway Department, probably worked with TDOT and came up with that design. And I'm not trying to be. I'm just answering information. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Last word to Sherry Hammond, if any.
Okay.
All right, last round of questioning, starting with BrentWord Communications.
How are you as a state legislator going to foster relationships with governing bodies at the local level, specifically the county commission and local school board?
Representative Cassidy.
Well, I think it's already there. As I mentioned earlier, the overwhelming majority of those who represent the 63rd House District has endorsed me for re-election because I work with them. I'm at their meetings. My cell phone is always open to them. We sit down over coffee and visit quite regularly. And so it's building and maintaining that relationship, knowing and understanding their needs, and voicing that and articulating that to the governor and the various departments that we interface with. So I will continue on what I have done successfully year to date.
Sherry Hammond.
In fact, though, Mr. Cassidy, you didn't work collaboratively with the school board, especially during this last season, because there was 3 out of 7 resolutions that we took that you had either sponsored or co-sponsored a bill that we believed was not in the best interest of Williamson County, and there was no collaboration. On the other side of that coin, there was a bill that you proposed that was going to put cameras on the outside of buses, and you said, quoted in the paper quoted, you have saying that you were working with the school board, when in fact you were not. So I think there has been a lack of collaboration, especially with the school board, and I can speak to that since I am a school board member. For me personally, I will continue that, and absolutely working hand in hand with the school board. I have great relationships with the school board, with the mayors, with the city commissioners, with the aldermans, and I look forward to continuing to have those conversations.
Last word.
My rebuttal is a lot of what you all oppose is the Republican agenda of conservative government for education. I am plugged in to the citizens of the county, and if they want choice on their education program, I will work towards that choice. If a school board member comes to me and says, hey, the school board's on board with this, relating to the camera arm on school bus, the camera on school buses, I think he's talked to you on, so I've worked with him on those. And so I work collaboratively with local government, but you, the voter, are the ultimate authority. And if you feel like you're not being represented and not being heard by the school board, you come to me. And that's, I'm listening to you first and foremost.
Right. Thank you very much. The Tennessean has the next question.
I'd like to repeat a question for each district. So this is for both candidates. What is your philosophy on giving financial incentives to businesses to expand or move here?
Mr. Castor.
The governor has come in 4 years ago and totally revamped the ECD. You don't see the corporate giveaway that you once did. Now, mm-hmm. You will immediately point to Volkswagen, and that point will be well made. The governor would articulate that there are occasions where we need to have state tax dollars going to corporations to attract them to come. What you see difference under the Governor Haslam plan and the Governor Haslam's ECD is that there are now strings and requirements. Unlike GM, who came in and nearly packed up and folded tent, there was no obligation on their part. If Volkswagen were to do that, there would be some penalties. And so I applaud the ECD under the governor's leadership to do it. Now, one more to that point. The governor's emphasis now is on small business and making sure that the taxes and regulation is low and the infrastructure is sound so that small business and businesses that are already here can expand. And that's what we want. That's job growth in this nation and this state as the small businessman. But we will try to compete with other states on large corporations.
Sherry Hammond.
Yeah, I think certainly bringing forth business principles, you have to look at each of the situations individually. I'm certainly for extending those type tax credits and whatnot to businesses. And again, you have to balance that about the return or the net dividend that you're going to get and the benefit to the state, to the economy. the jobs that you're going to bring forth, the other companies that they may bring forth. So I think you have to look at each one of those on a case-by-case basis. I really do. I think it would be interesting to note, if Mr. Castor, if you wouldn't mind sharing with us, did you support the Nissan when Nissan was coming in a number of years ago? And did you support that them receiving tax abatements to go in?
The bill, and I'm assuming this is in order. Is this an order? I mean, I didn't know we could do
it. Well, this is your 30 seconds.
If my memory is right, and I used to be dark-headed, now I'm blonde, but my memory is that I put up a vigorous fight to oppose Nissan. That's $20,000 per job, $20,000 of your taxpayer dollars going to one job. I opposed the legislation, was very strongly opposed to it. But at the end of the day, when it came in through the budget, I did support that. But I think that is not, since I got time left, that is not a prudent use of your taxpayer dollars. Almost $20,000 of your tax dollars went to create one job. We need to be smarter than that, and under Governor Haslam's leadership and his ECD, the state of Tennessee is.
Thank you. Pam Horn, Williamson Herald, last question.
I have a question regarding fiscal issues. The state budget came up a little short on its projections this year, and with over $200 million short, Representative Casta, how did you see that happening? Was that something you all saw coming? Was that a situation that was there somebody not doing their job in state government and departments, or was that more of a let's look at the incentives and the law the way it's written and see if there are opportunities for folks to get around important revenue that the state needs?
Can I go? I went first last time. Is it okay if I go first again? What's the rules here?
She addressed the question.
Okay,
to you.
Fair enough.
Flip.
I just don't want to get in trouble. All right. No, we actually didn't until it was too late. I mean, it didn't just happen in the month of April that we're $200 million short. No. But we did see throughout 2013 and even through 2014 that there were shortfalls. And we knew by early, I'm looking at the chairman of finance back there, by early March, mm-hmm. where it was. We knew it was franchise and excise tax. And so we have a team of attorneys and accountants looking on how, what we think is some corporations are moving maybe, don't hold me to this, don't quote me, maybe moving warehouses outside the state to avoid franchise and excise tax. And so we're looking at solutions. If that is what indeed is happening, we're looking at what are the solutions to that. So yes and no, Pam, to your question on the surprise.
Sherry Hammond.
That was the same information that we heard and I had inquired about and had discussions with Representative Sargent about as well. I do look forward to getting in there and helping to see that we can to find out what we can do to resolve the corporate franchise and excise tax situation. Revenue forecasting obviously is critical to a budget. And, you know, some things that I have heard that is it true that perhaps 5 to 10% of our companies are paying up to 90% of that tax? You know, we've got to go in and see what's happening. It'll be critical going forward for budgeting purposes to have accurate and reliable revenue forecasting.
Okay, last word, Mr. Cassidy.
No last word.
Okay, and last question, Mr. Tom Lawrence.
Very brief, two one-word answers. Kevin Huffman, yes. Kevin Huffman, no. Connie Clark, yes. Connie Clark, no. Whoever wants to go first.
Sherry Hammond, your turn.
Connie Clark, yes. Kevin Huffman, you know, I think that's up to the governor to decide that and come alongside it, and I wouldn't speak forth on that at this point. I think that's his decision to make there.
I did not sign a letter, Tom. And so, Kevin Huffman, it's not my decision. That's the governor's decision. Do I disagree with about everything on Common Core that he's put forward? Yes. Again, not my decision. Judge Clark, undecided. I'm going to sit down. I've been a little busy this summer, and I haven't done my research on the Supreme Court judges. That's not a good answer, but it's the best I can give you. I know there's some allegations that maybe she's been soft on crime. soft on business. I don't see it. I find her to be an extremely intelligent woman. Mm-hmm. But before I make that yes or no, I've got some work to do.
All right. We'd like to thank both of you for being here and coming up with some great answers for us. And I'm glad that you mentioned the chairman of the Finance Committee being here, because I wasn't sure he was here yet. And he gets the days next. So thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening. Next, we're going to hear from District 61, and this is going to be a one-sided non-debate, although I think that every member of the media should get two questions, one round or two rounds of questions, and be able to ask a follow-up since we don't have a rebuttal. You got that, Representative Sargent? Representative Sargent is challenged in the Republican primary by Steve Gowris. He declined to participate tonight, citing another obligation. So we are going to change it up a little bit. And since you don't have anybody to debate with, we're going to let the questioners ask one follow-up question as they choose their topics, and better be tough because he doesn't have an opponent up there. This is Charles Sargent, and the first question goes to BrentWord Communications.
Do I have an opening remark?
I'm sorry, I forgot your opening statement. There's so much commotion in here. Go for it.
Thank you. I appreciate that very much. Yes, I want to thank BrentWord for putting this on. Thank the people for coming out tonight. We're looking at 7:30 at night, and we still have a good crowd of people here, and these are what you call interested citizens. So I do appreciate it, because I know there's a lot of things that everyone could be doing on a Thursday night. What I want to start with is basically what we've accomplished in the last 4 years under the leadership of Governor Haslam. I've been fortunate enough to be picked as the finance chair for the last 4 years, and this has been a very exciting time. We have reduced the size of government. When I say we reduced it, we actually have about 4,000 less employees today than we did 4 years ago. We've cut taxes. This is something that I am extremely proud of. We have been able to totally do away with the gift tax. We are phasing out the inheritance tax. We have reduced the sales tax on food by 0.5%. I also have the bill that we're working on with Dr. Laffer that will work on phasing out the halls tax. We've created jobs in this county and the state. We've been rated one of the top states for automotive industry and a number of places like that. And Better education has to be our main focus. I've been very instrumental in getting the Columbia State Project here, and very proud of Columbia State being located at the new campus.
Breaking ground tomorrow. And let's go with Jessica.
Williamson County has designated funding for working with local and state level government in the coming year on addressing transportation issues across the county. What are some of the ideas you have for addressing traffic and roadway problems?
Well, traffic is a major concern, especially when we have it one of the fastest growing counties in the state. As previously been said, we are doing a number of road projects here in the state, and there's a number of road projects going on that we don't realize yet because we're buying right away up. If I look at Franklin Road will be widened from Concord Road down to Moore's Lane. They are looking at moving the utilities at this point in time, and that would be four lanes. We have to continue our vigilance on building the roads and making sure that we're spending our money wisely and picking the roads we need to do.
All right, Do you have a follow-up?
What can you do to expedite funding for the MacHatcher bypass?
That, the next section going from Hillsborough Road over to 96, we looked at this year, and we were not able to do it, not knowing exactly, as you know, the federal government, on August the 15th, the highway department road money is being, actually is broke on August the 15th. Without the reauthorization, it's very hard for us as a state to plan for a $20, $30, $40 million project when we're not sure exactly how much federal money we're going to have. So we put that off a year, and I'm fairly sure that the federal government turns around and reallocates the money. We'll be able to get that into next year's budget or in the next year's three-year plan.
All right, Jamie from the Tennessean.
Yeah, it was said earlier that more money per capita for roads goes to Williamson County than anywhere else in the state. And Spring Hill is one of the fastest growing cities in the state. And that southern part of the county especially is growing. And traffic congestion obviously is their biggest challenge. On a Saturday down US 31, it can take up to an hour to get from one end to the other through Spring Hill. And they have sort of changed their outlook as to how they'd like to handle that. You know, they first wanted the interchange to be the top priority. Now they're looking at US 31, but they're going to fund it themselves, and it's a state road. What would you do to address traffic in Spring Hill?
Well, as you know, I do not represent Spring Hill.
Yeah.
But I will address the situation. This is something that should have been done 10 years ago. And I'm, you know, not going to say why it was done, why it wasn't done. But this is something we have to work with our cities, no different than I work very closely with Brentwood and Franklin. Concord Road, we've been working on Concord Road and the extension of that going over to Nolensville Road. No different than, I just said, Franklin Road and Highway 90, MacHatcher going over to Highway 96. You know, you have to work with your city and elected officials and work with TDOT and work with the governor to make sure we can get these things done. I'm very proud of what we've done in the 61st District, getting the roads we need and, you know, the four laning of MacHatcher from Franklin Road over to 96. And so I don't want to get into every district in the state, but yeah, I'd like to address the 61st district.
All right. Do you have a follow-up, Jamie?
No, no follow-up.
Pam Horn.
I was at a chamber meeting earlier this year, and you mentioned that you were kind of concerned about the Department of Corrections, that it had a budget that had was sort of out of control and had, I think, increased by maybe 50% over a year, and you correct me if I'm wrong. Just given the growth and the number of folks that are coming to Tennessee and the increase in adjudications, folks going into incarceration for, you know, however many years. I mean, they're not at the state local jails so much. Where are we with handling that situation?
Okay. Yes, we did discuss that, and thank you for the question. The Department of Corrections budget in the last 5 years has gone from approximately $40 million to $950 million, almost a 50% increase in a five-year period of time. I've been talking with the commissioner on a number of issues that we could do. I felt we could do a lot better job at. One of the issues was the cost of our food in the prison. I've been speaking to him for 2 years, 3 years on that. And finally, they went to a master menu. That seems very simple, but just going to a master menu, everyone knew what they were eating at every prison on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. They never had a master menu. So this year, if you looked in the budget, we reduced the food cost in the prisons by $7 million. And I still think it's a little high, and I believe we can reduce it probably by about another $7 million. The other thing we have to do is we have an excellent drug court here in Williamson County, and we are keeping people out of prisons, people that are drug addicts, and we also have a DUI court. Keeping them out of prison saves us a great deal of money. It saves us about $26,000, $27,000 a year. And the drug court is very successful. We have about a 78% passing ratio in our drug court, so that reduces the cost in prisons. We need to do a better job on looking at alternatives.
A follow-up for the Williamson Herald?
No, thank you.
No follow-up. And Tom Lawrence.
I've got a conundrum, Charles. It's my voice on your radio commercials.
I believe it's your voice. It's a lot better than my voice.
I love Steve Garris' Sonic Burgers and his Route 47, 44, Route 44 size milkshakes. I'll probably have one on the way home. So I think I'm just going to keep my mouth shut.
Oh, Tom.
All right. I'll throw one in there for you. Do you support government efforts toward rural preservation and historic preservation, or do you advocate unfettered property rights?
No, I believe in the preservation of our history here in Williamson County and throughout the country. A good example of this is what we do right here in Franklin, the historic preservation and the Carton Foundation, all they do. As you know, we're repaving, not we, the county is repaving the old Natchez Trace Road. And they're going to do a great job where they're taking up the pavement and putting it right back down after they dig it up and putting it back down. It's a new technology, and this would be a wonderful thing that we don't have to go in and disrupt all the landscape, all the beautiful vegetation out there, and going into the river. So I'm all for historic preservations. I go to the Heritage Ball every year. The money goes for preservation. The last 5 or 6 years, I've had a table, so I do everything I can to support them.
How about conservation in natural resources?
Most definitely. I think both goes hand in hand as far as that's concerned.
All right. And we'll go back to Brentwood for the second and final round.
What piece of legislation do you intend to revisit from the past session, and what specifically do you want to address?
One of the biggest things, the two basic issues. The biggest one is going to be the Hall's income tax. This is a very unfair tax that burdens Williamson County residents, percentage-wise, a great deal more than it does a lot of your rural counties. It affects Belmead and places like that, Oak Hill, Forest Hills. So, I've worked with Dr. Laffer to work on a formula to eliminate the Hall's tax. And also, our cities get about 37% of that money. So I've worked with the cities and the counties to see how we can do this, how we can phase this out, so it doesn't have an impact on any one given year. But if we give them a period of time, 6 years, 8 years, whatever that period of time is, that they can work this into their budget, and we're just not doing it one time. We're not putting all the costs down to local governments.
Do you have a follow-up for that?
No follow-up.
Okay, the Tennessean, last question.
What is your philosophy on giving financial incentives to businesses to expand, to move here?
You know, when we look at that, I think we have to be very diligent on that. Going back, if I went back 10 years ago, 12 years ago, there was no accountability once we gave a business X dollars to come here. In the last 4 years under the Governor Haslam and the leadership of Speaker Harwell, we've looked at and we've set up a metrics, we've set up a method on if they're going to create this many jobs, if they're going to have this much capital outlay. And so now there's a method. So when we're looking at a company that only has recruiting 200 jobs or 2,000 jobs, the metrics can become the same. So it's not overweighted just for your larger companies.
Follow up?
No, thank you.
All right, Williamson Herald, last question.
One of the pieces of legislation that did pass this year, and I know the delegation was very proud of, was the opportunity for communities to decide on wine in grocery stores. Could you just take us through this process, because it is going to be on the ballot, and I know the election commission folks are already working on, you know, just how they're going to staff this, the signing of the actual petition has to be done prior to it getting on the ballot, and I know they want it on the ballot in November, I believe.
Correct.
The deadline for that petition is in August, I believe, and then they have to check and make sure and verify that every single person that signed that petition does indeed live in Williamson County, and there has to be a certain percentage. But could you just share with us the how you all got to that legislation and what your hopes are for it?
It started out to be a very simple bill, wine in grocery stores. Well, no bill that complicated, because our liquor laws have not been changed probably at all in the last 60, 70 years. And everyone thinks of when we started out and it got very detailed, everyone thinks of wine in grocery stores, you think of your Kroger's, your Publix, and things of that nature. And then it came in, what do we do with your Sam's and places like that? Then all of a sudden, your convenience stores say, well, we want to be part of this also. So we kept on going, and I was not the principal sponsor on this as far as that's concerned. So they sat down, and I was in a number of meetings on it. They sat down and tried to work this out to include everybody in it. Then, actually, in the grocery stores, you will not be able to buy wine in the grocery stores until July 1 of 2016. That came about to give the regular liquor and wine stores that we have today a chance to remodel themselves, because this was going to be a big shift for them. So we had to give them there again time to let them figure out their business, their new business model, how they were going to do it, what else they were going to sell, no matter if it was ice or mixes or something on that nature. So this was just a bill that took probably 6 months of working out, working back and forth, and I still think that next year we'll come back and probably make some more adjustments to the bill, because I don't think it's in the best form it is as far as that's concerned.
Follow up?
Will the election, though, have any bearing on your changes in the future?
No, I don't. Because the elections are going to be inside the cities that have already have liquor by the drink, or where there is a liquor store or a wine store today. You still will not be able to, a misnomer, you will not be able to go to, say, College Grove grocery store and probably buy wine, because they, at the present time, do not have liquor by the drink or a liquor store. It's always inside the cities, the municipalities themselves.
But just for clarification, even though the vote comes up this fall, there will be no implementation of this law until...
No, there will be implementation. Your wine and liquor stores will be able to sell products, I believe it's September 1, they'll be able to sell other products than wine and liquor. They can sell mixes and stuff of that nature. That gives them that chance, a year and a half, 18, 20 month catch up, so they can remake themselves instead of just all of it, all of a sudden, everything changes.
But the actual wine in the grocery stores would not happen before July 2016.
Correct.
Just for clarification. Thank
Correct.
You.
I hope I answered your question.
I think you did. Thanks.
All right, and I guess I'll wrap it up with one last question about a Governor Haslam policy to the Finance Committee Chairman. In seeking to educate tomorrow's workforce, can the state afford and sustain a policy of free tuition for residents at community colleges?
That's a very, very good question. I want to make one thing explicitly clear. No taxpayer's dollars is paying for this. everyone turns around and think taxpayer dollars are paying it. There is not a penny of taxpayer dollars going into this program. This program has been set up with the reserve account out of the Hope Scholarship. We had over a $350 million reserve account in the Hope Scholarship. As you know, the Hope Scholarship revenues all come from the sale of lottery tickets and scratch-offs. So that's why I'm saying there's no taxpayer dollars in this. We've taken that money and put it into an outside trust. And this would be done over the next 6 to 12 months, because there's other money flowing into this from the Hope Scholarship. So that money would be placed in there. It would be also what I'm going to call the last dollar scholarship. If your child goes to a community college, they have to apply for all the scholarships, the Hope Scholarship, the Pella Grants, everything they can apply for and qualify for, that will come first. So we are looking at the cost of that scholarship, the last dollar, should run about $825 to $875 per student per year. But there's no taxpayer dollars in this whatsoever. And a lot of people think this is taxpayer dollars. It is not.
Okay. And my follow-up is that going to be implemented by the time we have a new campus here?
That will go into effect, no. Well, we hope the new campus of Columbia State that we're breaking ground on, I can't believe Tom's not going to ask a question on Columbia State, but excuse me, Tom, I didn't mean to bring you back into it. We're hoping that the January of 16, the first class will start at Columbia State. Last dollar scholarship will be implemented in, if everything gets in place, it'll be for the fall year of 15. So that will be a little bit ahead of the Columbia State project.
All right. Well, we thank you for being here tonight. I'm sorry your opponent couldn't make it. I hope it wasn't too much of a love fest for you. And we'd like to thank members of the media for being here and members of the audience. And, well, nobody got a closing statement on the other panel, okay. So we're going to have to wrap it up here. And BrentWord Communications, publishers of the Brentwood, Franklin, Spring Hill, and Nolensville home pages, is the producer of this event. And there's a next one on July 28th for school board candidates. And don't forget that early voting is upon us.
Tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock.
That's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming. That was a fire. Let's go get a milk. I would try to go.